Thank you. Good morning, church. We are welcomed and blessed to have you here today with us. Those joining us online, we say welcome and thank you for your presence as well. We're coming to this building to enjoy the warmth and the fellowship that we have together in Jesus Christ. And so we are thankful for your presence. We do have a couple of announcements that I want to share with you. First and foremost, tomorrow is our congregational meeting, or not tomorrow. Hey, you never know. Keep you on your toes. Next Sunday, so that would be on the 28th, is our annually called congregational meeting. You'll find in the back, we have our annual reports for you to review. If you do take one home with you today, we would encourage you to bring it back with you on next Sunday, so we don't have to print up multiple copies. And for those of you who just want to peruse the light reading of the version, you can pick up one of these copies. We've got some wonderful people here on staff. But it is a time in which we will come together and do the important work of the ministry of this church. And so we are required with the Book of Order to announce these weeks before, so consider that done. Also, we do have our Alive Fellowship is meeting today. That's for 50-year-old and beyond. They're meeting at Sue Radloff's home at 2. You can find more information in the bulletins. Our Bible studies are starting up again this week, Tuesday, Thursday morning. You'll find more information. And we also have our Strive Fellowship group, which is meeting at the church in the youth room here tomorrow night at 6. We've changed things up a little bit, but you'll find more information in your bulletins as well. The youth have a mission trip meeting today down in the youth room at 11 o'clock, and that'll be followed by their Lift Sunday School. And finally, we have a specially called session meeting for active session or active elders. It'll be in the parlor at 10:45 just to approve our final budget, which will be presented to the congregation next Sunday. And so with that, those are my announcements, but I do want to invite forward Gloria Onenson, who is going to share with us about an exciting new Presbyterian women's mission opportunity. So, Gloria.
Good morning. You will also find in your bulletin a little information sheet about a special project that we are doing together with all of the women in our synod. Our synod, for those of you who maybe don't remember, encompasses Wisconsin, Minnesota, Iowa, Iowa, the Dakotas, and I think Nebraska. And we're joining together to help the reservations, to help the young mothers in the Dakotas. They don't have a lot of extra income coming in other than what they can create on their reservations and do in working. And there's a real need for young mothers and need supplies for when they have a baby. So we're putting together baby layette kits. And so anything that you can contribute, monetary donations are also welcome, but there's great sales going on right now to pick up things for babies. So there's a list in your bulletin. And we have a plaque and pack and play that's already set up in the fellowship hall for you to drop those items in. They will be picking them up the early part of April, so we'd like to have those here in the facility by the 24th of March, if you can do that. So everyone here is so great in sharing and helping when there is a need, and we really appreciate all that you can do to help these new babies have a great start and have the supplies that they need. Thank you.
Thank you, Gloria. And indeed, that is an important mission that we're proud to be able to support. And so now let us focus our attention to our God as we worship Him in spirit and in truth. stand for opening hymns found in your supplemental hymnals. Those are the folders behind the Bibles and the hymns. We'll be singing Cry of My Heart and In Christ Alone.
Thank you. Dear God, thank you for the opportunity to come to your house and worship today and gather as a church family. Thank you for your loving kindness and manifest goodness. Please help us to always be mindful of the love, care, protection, and grace that you extend to us every day. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. The Old Testament lesson today comes from Joshua chapter 24, verses 14 and 15. You'll find it in your pew Bibles on page 216. Now therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Thanks to God for his holy word.
Give her a battery, offer up a holy journey. And we do thank our Ascending Truth Group for leading us in worship this morning. Now we get to come before God with our prayer and praises. And we do have two to add before we start. Meredy has asked that we pray for her niece, Gloria, who has been diagnosed with cancer. And we also have a praise that Nikki Nelson is back with us in worship. So, hi, Nikki! So we're just very grateful for that. Yes, Mike.
I also have a praise. I want to thank God that the most amazing woman in this world has stood by my side for 34 years as of yesterday. So we are blessed, and God continues to bless us. So thank you back there.
Are there any other prayers? Well, let us go to our God then. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for the love and joy and peace that you pour out on us. And we thank you for hearing us in our time of prayer. And so, God, we ask that you hear us now in this time of silent meditation. And God, you know all that is on our hearts, whether we speak it aloud or pray it silently, and we thank you for hearing us this morning. And we'd like to lift up to you Jim Jays, who will be having cataract surgery on the 22nd and 25th. We ask that this surgery just be successful and ask for healing. We ask for prayers for Bob Klain's family as he has passed away. We ask that you surround them in comfort during this time. We lift up to Virginia, who has moved to Fieldcrest in Hayfield, and we ask that this is a smooth transition and that she is fitting in well there. We pray for those with inadequate housing or have to work outside during this cold spell, and God, we ask that you continue to keep them safe. We lift up to you Matt Huff's Uncle Larry's niece, Jennifer, who may have colon cancer, and God, we ask for healing in her life. We ask for prayers for Cindy Goskison as she continues to heal from her fall, and God, just ask that you bring healing to her. We ask for healing for the residents at Good Samaritan who have COVID, and that you keep them safe. And we lift up to you Meredy's niece, Gloria, who has cancer. God, just pray for peace and comfort in her life. And God, we also come to you with our praises, and we thank you that Nikki has recovered and back to join us in church. And God, we thank you for the Olmsteads and their 34 years of marriage. And so, God, we also lift up to you those members we prayed for in our staff meeting, for Bonnie Bishop, Emily and Bobby Broughton, Brad and Marjorie Bridgman, Carson and Deanna Cordes, Pam DeLeon, Ozzie Earle, Sue Hodge, Joan Isley, Jenna Len's family, Vandy Newman, Mark and Tracy Olson, Bob and Patty Raymond, and Britt and Caleb Vundermachen. And so, God, we do just thank you for all the members of your church. And now, God, hear us as we pray the Lord's Prayer, which can be found on the screen behind me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And at this point, I'd like to invite forward our ushers for the offertory. And as they come forward, let us remember that every good and perfect gift is from our God. And in all the ways that we can give back to our God, he will use them for his kingdom purposes. And so, God, we ask these that you bless these gifts we are about to receive, and that through them people may know your love and the joy and peace that comes from you. Amen.
Yeah.
encourage you to remain standing and turn to your neighbors to greet each other with the peace of Christ. Return to your seats. I'd like to invite forward all the children up here with me. I'm just amazed I can carry all this right now. Hello. How's everyone doing? Got more coming? Hi. I love those light-up shoes. So cool. So I have a question for you. How many decisions do you think we make in a day? How many decisions?
As much as we can think.
As much as we can think. Do you think we make 5 decisions a day? About 20? How about 1,000? I know, I think for me it's like snooze alarm 1, snooze alarm twice, snooze alarm 3 times. Well, I have some things here, and I want you to decide which ones you like better, okay? So you can choose pretzels, or you can choose chips. So who here's a pretzel person?
Pretzel.
Pretzels?
Yeah.
Who is chips? Okay, chips went out. We have, would you rather read a book or watch a movie?
Watch a movie?
Read a book. Okay. So, like, these are some hard decisions, right? Now we got sports or music?
Music, sports.
Oh, my goodness. Wow. So you have to make so many decisions a day. But we read in our passage this morning that Richard read for us in Joshua, he said you have to make a choice, right? He said, choose this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods of the Amorites, but for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So every day when we wake up, you know what choice we have to make? You know it. Are we going to serve God? And the answer should be yes, because God loves us so much. And God sent Jesus to show us how to live and to die for our sins. So every day, what are you going to do? Who are you going to choose?
God.
Jesus, God, yes. All of the above. All right, will you all pray with me?
Yeah.
Dear God, we thank you so much for your love. And we just ask that you help us make the right choice every day, that we will choose to serve you and you alone. And all God's children said, amen. All right, and now it's time for Sunshine Singers. If you're up to second grade, so go find Miss Anne in the back. And I'm going to ask Callie to maybe like take these drums for me so I don't drop them.
Thank you, Britt. Wonderful job as always. And next time, I hope there's 100% agreement that basketball is better, but that's okay. Still got room to grow. I thought I'd share this based on our current weather condition. I got this wonderful poem. It's a mnemonic on understanding how many days there are in each month. You might remember it. Says 30 days has September, April, June, and November. Unless a leap year is its fate, February has 28. All the rest have 3 days more, excepting January, which has 6,184. I feel like we are well into the 6,000 days of January. But we do praise God that His blessing has come, as it always does, and things are warming up a little. One of our congregation members this morning reminded me the good things of this weather. No mosquitoes. So I think we can be thankful for that as well. But we do move forward in our faith, and we are continuing on in our series, Reboots. Today we are talking about rebooting our families, and we're doing so with our text from Hebrews 5:11 through chapter 6, verse 3. You'll find that if you want to open up with me on page 220. But I do want to give, again, a little bit of background into where we are in the book of Hebrews. Again, this is a dissertation, a letter, if you will, on the supremacy of Christ in all of creation. We have heard early on, 2 weeks ago, that Christ is greater than the angels. Last week, the focus was that Christ is greater than Moses. Today, the focus in our text is that Christ is greater than the high priests. You can see the progression of this author who is reminding these Hebrew believers that are now tempted in the desire to go back to their original faith. But he is laying out the groundwork for the case of Christ, the supremacy of Jesus Christ above all else. And so we've dealt with the angels, Moses, and now the high priests. And if we look at the beginnings of chapter 5, the focus gives us in these first couple verses, it is virtually the perfect job description of a high priest. They were to be selected among men, representatives before God. They would offer gifts and sacrifice on the Day of Atonement in the Holy of Holies, and ultimately that they were called by God. And now in verses 8 through 10, our author confirms that Jesus Christ has met and exceeded each one of these guidelines, and he has now become the perfect high priest. Listen to what our author says before we get into our text. It says, "The Son, though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, and was designated by God to be high priest in the order of Melchizedek." And we will look in a few weeks at this high priest named Melchizedek. But what we are hearing here today is that Jesus Christ is the perfect example of what a high priest is and should be. But now in our text, we take a bit of a turn, if you will. For the author has proclaimed who Christ was, but now he spends almost two chapters reversing his step and speaking to his audience. And he is challenging them. He gives them a stern warning of not to be spiritually immature. So with a quick and abrupt pivot, the reader is challenged now to strive for maturity in their lives and to grow in their faiths. They are being asked, if you will, to reboot their beliefs. For these Jewish listeners, this would have been some tough love that was shared, because the author is disappointed, frankly, in their lack of progress. One author says, "They were yet where they began, at the starting gate." And I want you to imagine a horse in the Kentucky Derby or an Olympic sprinter in the blocks of the 100-meter gold medal race. The gates swing open, the gun sounds, yet there they remain, not moving forward. Our author is saying to his audience, it's time to start running the race. And I think that's an example for all of us to learn from as we seek to reboot our lives, but also the lives of our families. So let's read now out of the text, chapter 5, verse 11 through chapter 6, verse 3. About this, we have much to say that is hard to explain. Since you have become dull in understanding. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic elements of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is unskilled in the world in the word of righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, for those who lack faculties have been trained by practice to distinguish good from evil. Therefore, let us go on toward perfection, leaving behind the basic teaching about Christ and not laying again the foundation, repentance from dead works and faith towards God, instruction about baptisms, laying on of hands, and resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. And we will do this if God permits. Lord, we ask that you will bless this word to our hearing and our understanding, and may we be driven forward in our faiths because of it. We ask this in your name. Amen. Well, today, our focus again is on rebooting our families, and we'll speak to how this text can help us with that. But as I was focusing on this week, the question kept coming to my mind when thinking of our families. Are they a burden or a blessing? Are our families a burden or a blessing? And I think some of us may be in the point of view that we should take off the first two letters of the sermon title and it should just be called Boot Our Families. But the reality is, and I don't want to minimize the deep and seated pain that can grow inside of us because of families and the dysfunction and maybe some of the struggles that we face. But we also need to acknowledge as well that our families bring with it a unique blessing for each one of us to grow in and grow with. And that's the question as we speak to our families is, how do we consider them? Are they a burden or are they a blessing? And I know in many ways the answers are both. But predominantly, where are we? How do we stand with our families? Oftentimes, I think it is easy for us to get stuck in the struggles that family lives create. I know for me, as the youngest son, have an older brother and had a wonderful family to grow in. But still, there are times where I am stuck in that role of the youngest child. 58 years old, but still, there are situations and where instantly I'm just transported back into the youngest member of the family. And I know for all of us, for the rest of you, you have labels, you have struggles, you have identities that you are still stuck in. There are old agendas, there are old pains, there are old regrets, old traditions. But we are called to move out of the old and into the new. And that is what we see with our word, with the words here in this text in Hebrews. Because he is speaking to one large family. That's how the Hebrews viewed themselves, as a unique family that would function together. But now these practices, these struggles, these pains are returning to this current family, and they're pulling them back. And so from the text, I believe that this can be a time in which the author tells his current readers they need to reboot their family. But I believe it's also a time where we, as modern day hearers of this word, that we too can reboot our lives within our families and within our faiths. And the author, he divides his audience, he speaks of two different identities. We'll call them the milk drinkers and the meat eaters. And he is speaking to, in these last three verses in chapter 5, to the milk drinkers. Those who are living a life of immaturity in their faiths. And the author identifies three different kind of categories with this. The first in verse 11 and 12, that they were sluggish in their hearing. The next was in verse 12 and 13, they had a diet that was meant for infants rather than for adults. And then finally, in verse 14, they are told that what they need to do to move forward in maturity is to transition between the milk of a child and the meat of an adult in faith. And so looking at this first category, sluggish in hearing, this was the charge against them, that they no longer were active in hearing God's word. It says, about this, we have much to say that is hard to explain, since you have been sluggish in your hearing. He is speaking to a church that has been well established and has been taught well over the years. But they have not grown forward because they were sluggish. The Greek word here is nothros, which means to having lost momentum, being dead in the water, apathetic, dormant. This is what the author is claiming this church has become. Even earlier in the text, in chapter 2, verse 1, the author warns the believers against drifting away from God. It's not that they have drifted away, it's just that they haven't moved forward. They are still stuck in the starting blocks. And they have not used God's word to pull them into the future that God would have them. There should have been a natural progression. Believing in God's word, learning from God's word, studying God's word, and then being able to proclaim God's word. But they were still stuck in that first phase. Initial belief, they had not moved forward. And because of this, then the author tells them about their diet. In verse 12 and 13, it says, "You need milk and not solid food, for everyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is unskilled in the word of righteousness." Now, most of you know of or know my children, Tommy and Jeremy, and there's nothing better than I enjoy doing is placing a good old medium rare ribeye right on the plate in front of them. They love it, as does Stephanie, as does my wife. We enjoy meat. But you know what? When they were 6 months old, I'm not dropping a medium rare ribeye steak right in front of them, am I? No, they need a progression. Their diet cannot handle the mature foods of an adult. This is what our author is saying, is that you are stuck in that infancy. You should be able to digest the word of God, to learn and to go forth. You should be able to follow the example of righteousness. For that's what they weren't able to do. They were stuck on a diet of milk. and they weren't able to see the righteousness of God before them. That was both their physical and their spiritual reality. And the author says they are unskilled in the word of righteousness. Well, they will not be able to move forward in faith until they begin to understand, to take in the nourishment of God's word and God's righteousness. And that's what he tells them to do in verse 14. He said, "For solid food is for the mature, for those whose faculties have been trained by practice to distinguish good from evil." These early believers that had not progressed forward could no longer discern good versus evil. And so what was happening to them? They were being pulled back into their old practices, their old sins, their old disobedience, their old worship of false gods, because they could not see God's word, God's will, and God's way in front of them. They were turning into a faithless generation, just like a myriad of generations of their forefathers and foremothers that had come before them. That is why we had learned from the example of Moses. Is that generation that was freed from Pharaoh's captivity, they cannot enter the promised land because they were unfaithful in the wilderness. They could not discern God's way and God's will. And that is what our author is warning us about as well. I don't know if you see it, but I definitely do. In a culture, in a country, in a community in which we proclaim that we are believers in Christ. But can we really see the discernment between good and evil? It's hard to grasp the fact that we are a culture that is moving forward in faith based on the headlines, based on the struggles, based on the evil that still exists in our world. And I fear that as a church, globally, that we are still stuck in the starting blocks. We still are choosing milk over the meat that God gives us. But He is calling us to something greater, something bigger. Listen to the beginning of chapter 6. "For He has called us to go on towards maturity." Another way of hearing this simply is grow up. Believers, grow up. We are called to a spiritual growth. We are called to a maturity that will move us towards perfection and completeness. Now, I know there are some times where we force like we are kicking, we have to go kicking and screaming into God's presence. But there are times in our life where we have had to grow up. What about the first day of school? What about the first time that we went away to a camp without our parents? What about our high school graduation, our first job, getting married? The list goes on and on. There are times in our lives where we don't feel like we can move forward, but we are still called to do so. For me, I can identify a single day in my life in which God told me, "Mike, it's time to grow up." That was the day in which, for some reason, the nurses and the doctors of the hospital that we were in gave to me, most importantly gave to Colleen, our child, Tommy, and said, "Okay, see you later." Raise your hand if you've ever been in that position and sheer panic took over your life. I remember putting Tommy and somehow trying to figure out how to strap his car seat into the back seat and do it the right way. And I thought, oh my goodness, I'm praying for this kid now. But that reality forced me to grow up, not just in that moment, but for the rest of my life. I have viewed the importance of fatherhood, of being a parent. That has transformed me into being a better person, I believe, a better father, a better son, a better husband. Because God told me, Mike, you can do this, but it's time to grow up. And that's the message we have in verses 1 through 3. I think one author said a great title for this would be, Come, Get Ready, and Go. But for me, it's the old playground thing that we would say as we were racing across the school grounds. Get ready, get set, and go. First, we get ready. Our author has given us six foundational truths that we can build our lives around. And in each one of those sections, there are two that will transform us. So how do we get ready? It says, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God. Repentance and faith. That's how we ready ourselves. With confession, with forgiveness, with depth and growth. Standing firm in our faiths. We are called to have an upward focus. And when our author says that we need to leave the elementary teachings of Christ and press on towards maturity that we see in verse 1, this isn't something we leave behind. This is something that we take forward on our journey into God's future. And so the first thing we take with us as we get ready is our repentance and our faith, the basics of who we are as believers, understanding our brokenness, and understanding the victory that comes through Christ. So we get ready. Next, we get set. Verse 2 says, you need to learn from the instruction about washings and laying on of hands. These were two Jewish and Christian traditions. Cleansing ourselves by washing ourselves clean in God's love. And then there was the laying on of hands, which was a practice of prayer and healing in the early church. So we have an upward focus, but we also have an outward focus, that our faith is important for others. We are to wash ourselves through baptism, but we are also to lay hands on others through prayer and healing. That is how we set ourselves for the future that God will lead us into. And then finally, in verse 3, we are told to go. He tells us about the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. Through the resurrection, we find our eternal hope of salvation. And through judgment, we find the righteousness of God will prevail. We go forth with an inward focus, understanding the hope and the victory that lies in front of us. So the message today is to go forth in that maturity. That was the message to the Hebrew family of faith, but it's also a message to each one of us in our own families. Get ready, get set, and go. We are to lift our families upward with repentance and forgiveness. Let's not hold anyone shackled in the past. Let's forgive. Let us move forward. And as hard as some of those wounds have been, I'm not saying that it will be easy, but God calls us to forgive. And so we move forward in that forgiveness and in that repentance. Secondly, with our families, we are called to love our families outwardly, to wash away the struggles of the past, and to bless them with prayer and healing. Again, there are no perfect families out there. We are all dysfunctional. But we love and we worship a perfect God. And it is only through Him that we can move towards that maturity. And we do that by inwardly learning of God's eternal hope and victory for me, but also for my family and for those around us. That's how we reboot our families, is we look for the eternal hope of God's victory, God's salvation, and God's presence. I want to close with the words from Joshua that Richard read for us earlier. Joshua says, "Now therefore, fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity and in truth. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Brothers and sisters, let us make that similar commitment to the families that we have. Whether your predominant feeling is that of a burden or a blessing, let us step forward in faith. Let us commit our families to our God, and let us serve Him with maturity. Amen. Amen. Thank you. And now let us stand for a closing hymn. It is "Leaning on the Everlasting Arms," hymn number 496. That is out of your regular hymnals. Our benediction, I would like to invite everyone into the fellowship hall for a time of connection and fellowship, but we also do have our elders will be meeting at 10:45 in the parlor. At 11 o'clock, our Beyond the Pulpit will meet in the parlor as well. We have our youth and student, our youth and parent mission trip meeting at 11, and we have our Sunday school for the kids starting at 10:45. So now let us receive the blessing of our benediction. May we go forth in the power, peace, and protection of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.